Turkey has a very long history about its cuisine, especially in sweets. In this presentation, Z.Begum Kalyonac will show us many kinds of Turkey sweets and point out some interesting relationships between sweet and culture in Turkey.
So actually, the traditional culinary legacy in Turkey, it mostly passes from mother to daughter. It can be mother-in-law to the bride, and it can be from the master chef to the apprentice. It can be from the vocational high schools, from the university gastronomy department recently, and from the culinary institute's cooking classes that might last from one day to 1 year. Also, women TV programs, especially the morning TV shows, are quite important in teaching people the recipes. And of course, internet. Now everybody uses internet. Like I said to you, wheat is the main source of sugar in Turkey. We don't have sugar cane because of the dry climate that we have. You guys mostly have sugar from sugar cane. And these are the key ingredients in Turkish sweet culture all around the history. So molasses, sugar, honey, wheat flour, cow and goat milk, and fat. So they use clarified butter, normal butter, animal fat, and more recently also vegetable oils, like sunflower oil is also being used. And also, there are some toppings that we use mostly in order to ornate the ornamented desserts in Turkey. For example, granulated Antep pistachios. Antep, I'm going to actually talk about, it's one of the most gastronomic cities in Turkey. If you ever come to Turkey, it's a must destination. You should really see it because even in Istanbul, we cannot find as delicious desserts as you would find in Antep. Granulated nuts, egg, rose and rose water, fruits, tahini and mastic. So actually, I would like to divide Turkish sweet culture into three categories. The first category are the traditional Turkish desserts. The second category would be the traditional Turkish confectionery, because they are very different. And then the modern Turkish desserts and modern Turkish confectionery. There are lots of desserts and confectionery that I cannot fit into those mere three categories, but I will try to do my best at least like to summarize. Because hopefully if you come to visit Turkey, you will see the sweet culture is much more than what I'm going to tell you in this presentation. So, the traditional Turkish desserts, very roughly, we can divide it into three categories: milk-based desserts, desserts with sherbet, and fruit-based desserts. So, this is the first milk-based dessert, the most simple one, rice pudding, we call it sütlaç. Actually, this was considered as Turkish pudding in 16th century Italian writings. They were serving this in weddings and they were writing it on the menu as the Turkish pudding. I'm sure also in Asia, in many countries, they have this pudding as well. And okay, so this is a very interesting one. This is chicken breast pudding. I don't know if you use meat products in your desserts, but we use real chicken breast in this dessert. So actually, before the post-medieval era, Arabs and Roman empires, they were using meat and chicken in the desserts very much. But in, after the medieval period, this tradition got forgotten. So actually, only in Turkey, in our geography, you can find this pudding. And I can assure you that you will never taste chicken. It has this gooey texture, it's so delicious. Wonderful, like this fibrous texture, you should really try this. It might sound like a nightmare to a vegan, but if you're not a vegan, you should definitely try this pudding. And then, worm milk pudding. This is similar to the breast milk pudding, but it doesn't contain any chicken, so if you don't want to eat it, you can also go with this as well. This is the traditional ice cream. This ice cream started to be developed around 19th century. As you see, we serve it with fork and knife. The reason why we are serving this ice cream with fork and knife is it is so thick. Sometimes people can't even cut it with butcher's knife. But it has a very different texture compared to the other ice creams. It's definitely something to try as well. And let's continue with desserts with sherbet. First of all, is baklava. It's the sultan of my heart also, like one of the favorite desserts of all the Turkish people. And I also brought some baklava from back home, so you can try it after this presentation too. So these are the good baklava ingredients. First of all, starch, wheat flour, pistachio, but the pistachio should come from Antep, and it should be an early harvest pistachio. If it's not an early harvest pistachio, then it's not going to work. And it can be also, if you don't have early harvest pistachio, you can use walnuts. Semolina, clarified butter, milk, mostly goat milk, and sugar, and sherbet, of course. So actually, the each tissue, you have minimum 14 layers of dough. And those layers should be maximum 1 millimeter thick. And in the former times, around 17th, 18th century, in Ottoman Empire, they were making it with 300 layers of dough. It's a very artistic type of dessert, and you have to be very good at it, because timing is very important, when to pour the sherbet, how to do it. In the previous times, sometimes they were using kidney fat in order to make the pastry a little bit thinner, but don't worry, they're not using kidney fat anymore. And yeah, so like I said before, Gaziantep is the city where you should be trying this baklava. And we also have homemade baklava, if you have the patience. I mean, you can have a big dough, you can put 40 pieces, you can do it with just like 40 layers. I mean, you don't have to do it 300. And also, different types of baklava can be distinguished either with the cutting style. It can be cut as like squares, rectangles, or this type of shape. It can be distinguished with the type of nut that you use. But we have many different types of baklava. And then our other dessert with sherbet is kadayıf. Kadayıf was initially more like something like pancake, the one that you see here, this one. And then we also started to develop another type of kadayıf, which you see on the other slide, and it's also one of the most famous desserts, künefe. Künefe is the second most favorite dessert after baklava in Turkey. So this is also very much close to kadayıf. We have these künefe like ingredients, and in the middle is a cheese. It's the goat cheese, but it's a sweet thing, so you don't really feel the saltiness of the cheese. Highly recommend you, it's very delicious. Rebani, also another dessert with sherbet. And this is a dessert called kemalpaşa tatlısı. Like, I translated this as Atatürk dessert. Atatürk is the founder of the Turkish Republic. So actually, this dessert was created in the honor of Mustafa Kemal Atatürk. And then we have a dessert called wife's belly. I'm going to be talking about the aphrodisiac culture in Turkey as well, but we have lots of desserts that have these naughty names as well. Then we have the fruit-based desserts, queen's dessert. I don't know if you know the fruit queens, but we use it a lot in our cuisine. Then we have different forms of pumpkin dessert. We mainly boil the pumpkin, but then we boil it with sugar, and then we add some nuts on top of it. It sounds very simple, but it's very delicious. You should really taste it as well. And then another Ottoman dessert that was very popular is the cherry bread dessert. And then we have pear dessert, which is kind of similar to the queen's dessert, but very popular. We have the apple version of this dessert as well. So we talked about the traditional dessert. Now let's talk about the traditional confectionery. And the traditional confectionery, I divided into three: soft candies, hard candies, and helva. So first, soft candy. Probably you have heard of this one before, Turkish Delight. This was mostly became popular around 18th century. So by 1840, tourists start to come to Istanbul to get lokum, Turkish delight. You see lots of depictions of British women carrying Turkish delight packs in their hands. And you can find many different types of it. It has basically powdered sugar, lemon juice, and starch. But it has lots of tricks when you're making it. You need to, for example, have a marble surface in order to make it. You need to know the right time to cut it and everything. So it's also an art form by itself. And then we have the Turkish sweet meat. This is one of the earliest versions of the Turkish delight. And also, I think the first keynote speaker, she mentioned that they have something similar in India as well. And then we have the Turkish toffee, macun. And in the Turkish toffee, what is most important is that you should have around 40 types of different spices, sugar and honey. And it's been sold like this. And another soft candy is cezerye, which is carrot delight. And it contains carrots, sugar, walnut, biscuit and butter. This is mostly coming from a city called Mersin. And we decorate it with coconut. As you see in Turkey, we only use coconut and the brown coconut, shredded coconut, to decorate. Other than that, we don't really know how to use coconut. We don't really use it very much. And then we have the chestnut candy. So Turkey is one of the big producers of chestnut. And as you know, it's a very valuable nut, and the harvest, we have it in Turkey around September, October, and the hardest thing is to peel the chestnut, actually, and afterwards we have chestnut candy from it. So it's a bit of an expensive dessert, but it's a big delicacy, and I would recommend you to have it. Then we have the almond pistachio candies. That are made either from almond or pistachio with powdered sugar and lemon juice, and then they have been sold like little chocolates. And then we have pishmani. This is something more like a cotton candy. When I was a child, I was putting this on my hair to make my mom angry, actually. Like, it really looks like an old lady's hair. But it tastes very delicious. It's very simple. It has powdered sugar, flour, and butter in it. And then the hard candy is akide şekeri. Akit in Arabic means promise. So actually this candy has been symbolically used between the Ottoman militaries, the soldiers, to show their devotion to the Sultan. And it's like regular, you can think of it as like regular hard candy. But there were also versions of it with nuts inside. There is also another popular version, which is mint candy. It's mostly sold in trains, intercity trains, just like in Thailand. But this is a delicacy like that. And we have this nevet candy. This is very interesting, actually. This was used for the tea. It's such a delicate thing. Imagine having these nevet candy in your tea. It's very nice. So it can be made with saffron, it can be made with other flavors, and you can use it to sweeten your warm beverage. And then we have the mevlana, the rumi candy, which is very similar to this akide candy, but it has rose water and bergamot flavor as well. Okay, so when we come to helva, then this is the most basic type of helva, but we have lots of different types of helva. I think I'm going to mention about only three types of helva now. One of the most popular ones is the tahini helva, and this is something that can only be made with the hands. So again, you can buy it on the supermarket as a packaged product, but still it's a very artistic product. You cannot really automate this process. So it has tahini, sugar, lemon juice, and now, of course, after the 1845, when we have vanilla, we started to use vanilla in the modern times. Then we have summer helva, which also contains flour. And we have toast helva. This also exists in Iran. They call it gaz, we call it toast. And the ingredients are sugar, nuts, lemon juice, and gypsophila. We use gypsophila in Turkish delight as well. And when we come to the modern Turkish desserts and confectionery, of course, chocolate. comes into place, right? So before 1840, we didn't know about chocolate, and now that's almost all we know. Like, people are crazy about chocolate. And then we have the Franco-European pastry culture. Then maybe a bit more of current, but also the future trends, healthier versions of Turkish and international sweets that we have in Turkey. So as you see, this is the combination of the Turkish desserts with chocolate. We have chocolate tahini helva, chocolate chestnut candy. We have chocolate sauce on top of the pear dessert. We have chocolate baklava, chocolate delights. Delights are covered with chocolate, but these are all modern things. We didn't have these ingredients before. And then the Franco-European pastry culture. So the one that you see on the top left, at least to me it's top left, it's like a primitive version of a macaron. French people always make fun of this, but this is like a cookie that we love very much. It's an almond cookie. Then we have some other Franco-European pastries in Turkey, as you see, like regular things like waffles, so nothing super exciting. And these are the healthier versions of Turkish and international sweets. Like you see, we have baklava with stevia, and diabetic helva, and also diabetic Turkish delights, jams, and like the hazelnut pastries with chocolate. Actually, in Turkey, the most antisocial person consumes sweets at least 23 times per year, which is like every 2 weeks you must consume a sweet. And like, if you are consuming more, then of course you can do it, but we really consume it a lot.